and believe that they're doing those things and serving God. And certainly it's a wonderful thing to serve God, but it's certainly a terrible thing that they've been deceived in that. And so that's why I say in God's eyes, not in our eyes. We don't judge. We're not the standard. The world's not the standard. It's not our judgment as to whether we're in the Lord or not. It's rather God says that we are in. As I referred to in our Bible class this morning, we looked at Matthew 7, 21 and 22. And he says, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. And then the last part, verse 22, he says, I will say to them, I do not know you. So not every work that we might do, and it certainly could be a work, it certainly could have faith involved in it, but it won't save us because it's not God's work. And so what we've got to do is look at the scriptures and say, I'm going to be busy with God's work. We have some wonderful examples and what so many call, and I call quite often, the great hall of faith is Hebrews chapter 11. What a wonderful book that is. And certainly, you know, it's almost without without understanding why anybody could teach the doctrine of faith only and miss Hebrews chapter 11. This great chapter of faith, it even sets up what faith is. And yet people just overlook it. Notice as we go down, and we could spend a whole time in this 11th chapter this evening just looking at faith and the quality of faith. And I guess in a sense we'll be talking about it this evening in relationship to works. There are works that we need to do. They are not works of salvation, so therefore they're not our works. And they're not the kind of works that we can do to make God accountable to us so that he has to save us. That's just not true. And it's so sad that Luther and others just went too far. Luther tried to get back to the Bible, I think, in somewhat in what's called the Restoration Movement. But as so many said, and I think is true, because of the system that Catholicism has set up, and you could buy your indulgences, and just in case you sin sometime in the future, then you'd be forgiven. And so, and of course, they took up these great treasuries to build the cathedral at St. Peter's Cathedral in Rome. And so Tetzel sold a bunch of indulgences, and so people, especially rich people, could buy a lot of them, and so they'd have themselves covered for their sins. And certainly Luther saw that was wrong, and he's right, it was wrong. But in trying to get away from that, he, instead of ending up in Jerusalem, he just got so much head steam up, he ended up in running right dab, just right straight dab into the walls of Jericho. He missed Jerusalem altogether. And you know, religiously, most all of our denominational friends have missed Jerusalem. In their desire to serve God, they just missed it altogether. And so Hebrews chapter 11 reveals to us what faith is. And it is a work, but it's not ours. It's God's. So we work the work of faith in God's eyes. Hebrews 11 and verse 4. By faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and through it he, being dead, still speaks. I love that. You know, all these wonderful examples we read about Daniel and others in the Bible, these great Bible heroes, they still speak to us today, don't they? They still speak. The acts that they did have been recorded, and they still speak to every generation since. And so did Abel. And notice, as God required sacrifice, Abel was willing to do that. And God gave him testimony that he was righteous in doing that. If we desire to be righteous in the eyes of God, then we need to be obedient to God's will. Whatever it is, we need to be obedient to it. And God will give testimony that we've done which is right. And that's the idea of his righteousness. He did what was right. His brother, on the other hand, as we know, didn't. His brother chose to be like a lot of people in the world, and he decided because he grew vegetables, and maybe he had that prize vegetable, I don't know. You know, people who raise vegetables, you'll see it once in a while in the paper, they'll have a picture of this great big potato or whatever it might be, and so it's their pride. And so they put that and make an ounce of this vegetable. So I don't know what Cain offered by faith that Cain didn't. He went his own way. He did what was right in his own eyes instead of what was right in the eyes of God. And that's why Abel's testimony, or received this testimony of God. But the point is, God asked him to do something, he did it. Was Abel justified by that? No. But he was justified because he believed God and he did what God asked him to do. And that's literally a biblical definition of faith. Noah's obedience was a work of faith. Hebrews 11, verse 7. There it says, by faith Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. And each of these examples that we see through here, it says they were moved. God told them to do something, they were moved, and they did it. And certainly Noah was the same way. And you know, a lot of people during Noah's time was warned. Peter's indication is, if it's accurate, interpretation of that passage is that Noah was preaching for 120 years. So the ark was being built in 120 years, and during that time he was preaching to those that he lived or lived around him, trying to get them to listen to the warning of God. And perhaps, we don't know, but we could almost visualize, if it was like today, poor old Noah was laughed out of the community. And you can just imagine building that thing called an ark. And can you imagine just building that and a bunch of animals are going to go in it? How absurd. You could just hear the people in our world today. How absurd for that man. He must be a little bit crazy. He must be too religious. But Noah did not give in to that. He did not give in to any kind of threats. God asked him to do something. He warned him. And what did he do? He prepared the ark. He prepared. He worked. That was really something to make the ark with the hand tools that they would have had. And down in Kentucky, there is a ark that was set up to the very dimensions of the ark, at least as best we can tell in the Bible. And you can go down there and tour that. Part of it's wood, rest of it's not, but the dimensions should be specific to the scriptures, and it is unbelievable, the size of it. And God warned Noah, and we don't have any indication of rain up to that time, nor floods. And then, of course, not arks either. So God must have given him wisdom and instruction how to build this ark. And by faith, he moved and did what God asked him to do, not even knowing. In other words, this is how faith works. Had Noah been like everybody else, he couldn't have seen it. He couldn't have reasoned it. And so he'd just say, no, that's not going to happen. That's what the people in our world do today. That's impossible, Noah. And if you got it built, animals aren't going to come into it. I can hear our scientists say, you know, they're dangerous animals. They're not going to go into it. And if they did, they'd kill one another. You hear people just talk about this all the time. But did Noah listen? No. Noah listened to God. And so that which seemed to be impossible was possible. As the scripture says, as even our Lord says, all things are possible with God. Then also we see Abraham's obedience. Abraham certainly had some shortcomings, but Abraham was a great man of faith. And, of course, he is the father of a multitude. Not only is he father of the Israelite nation, but he's our father, too. And even to Jews and Gentiles and all nations alike. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to the place which he would receive as an inheritance, and went out. And here's what faith does. Faith will cause us to be able to do the impossibility, not knowing where he was going. God said, go. That was his home. That's where he lived for whatever, however old he was when he left. And God comes to him and says, you go. And you don't hear Abraham say, well, now, Lord, how am I to get there? And which road am I to take? And how do I know when I get there? And how much, you know, kind of a dangerous place to live in. Is we going to go into somewhere where somebody might kill me? You remember we saw the weakness of Abraham's faith in Egypt before two different kings as he lied about his wife, said she was his sister. So Abraham was a man of our type of character, and yet when God told him to go, he picked up his family, he picked up everything, and he went. Without question. And the interesting thing, even to top this, is that Abraham really never owned, other than a burial spot, anything in the land of Canaan. So that inheritance that God was talking about never happened to Noah or to Abraham, but it was to Abraham's generations, it was to his families, that promise was fulfilled. God fulfilled it, but that's not what the scriptures meant when God said he would give him this great land. He would give his seed. So that's the work of faith as we see it in the scriptures. And then the next thing that Paul talks about is the labor of love. And certainly we have a wonderful example of the labor of love. And we too need to follow that example. And once again, as I said, all these points is in God's sight. It's God's qualification. It's God's requirements. So as we look at this, we see that God's labor was a labor of love. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 11. I don't know if you've ever sat and contemplate things, especially scriptural things, the Word of God as to why things, as how they worked out and why God did things the way they did. And then you stop and think about humanity and our history that we have. And you know, I'm just not sure that I would see anything worthwhile in humanity. I know I'm part of it, but I'm just not sure that I would see anything worthwhile. Even today, the murders, the killings, the stealings, the lyings, divisions of families. And it just goes on and on. There's no end to it. And so we see all this hatred and all this sin that's gone on in this world before us. As we know in Noah's day, every thought of the heart was evil continually. And sometimes you wonder, are we in that generation and now again where people's hearts are evil continually? And so once again the question comes by, why did God save us? Well, there's only one answer and the scriptures provide it: love. In Ephesians 3 and verse 11 it says, according to the eternal purpose which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. Not only was God willing to do it, but God had a plan to do it forever. Think about love. You think about our Father that we serve. You know, as you look at the parable of the prodigal son, there's three people in that parable. There's three beautiful lessons in that parable. But one of those three individuals was the Father. And that Father was more like our Heavenly Father than you might want to think. A son who as the older brother said, he just wasted your living. And he couldn't understand why his father wasn't mad at him. And what did he do? But he ran out. And the Bible says he saw him afar off. So that indicates to me that his father went almost every day and looked in the direction that son left, hoping that son would come home. And he ran to him and he kissed him. That shows true love. That's how our Father loves us. In John chapter 3 and verse 16, I'm sure we all have memorized, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son." That is a labor of love. And we need to think more about that labor of love in our life. We need to follow that example because it will truly make our lives different. Jesus' labor was a labor of love. You just can't come up with any other conclusion because, as I've mentioned before, Jesus didn't have to be coerced by God. God didn't have to twist his arm to do it. He didn't have to do that. As we might say, and I'm not sure this happened, but just to kind of visualize in our mind, man was in sin and was in need of salvation, and Jesus says, "I'll do that." Do we have that kind of love? Do we have that kind of compassion? John 15 and verse 13. "Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends." Verse 14, "You are my friends if you do whatever I command you." We can have lots of friends in this world, but there's one friend that I want to have above every other friend in this world, and it's God, and Jesus Christ. Those are the true friendship. Or as the scripture says of David and Jonathan, that he was one that had that he was closer than a brother. This is such great bond and love between David and Jonathan, and not bad love as people want to make it today. It's the type of love that was emulated by God for us. And to have God's love is to do labors. Labors of love for everyone. Not pick and choose. It's so bad that we live in a world, and I know it's difficult, but people want to pick and choose who they're going to love. Who we're going to like. Who's going to be our friend. And sometimes we have a tendency to stay away from people that, you know, we don't evaluate the same as we are. It might be dirty, might have long hair, might have tattoos, earrings, all the kinds of things that are going on. It's probably just nothing more than an open rebellion against humanity and against God himself. A lot of them don't even realize it, nor realize what they're doing. We need to love those people too. We need to take the gospel to them, the down and out drunks, the Skid Row people. They need God. And Jesus gave a parable and really kind of asked a question and gave a parable of two individuals. And one received one thing and one received another. And Jesus taught the lesson, the one who receives the most or needs the most is the one that loves the most. And so think about down and out people who need to be loved, because a lot of them can be reached because some of them have reached the bottom in their life. And so we can have an opportunity to teach them. And we need to have that kind of love. 1 Peter 2 and 17. There the scriptures just simply says, "Honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king." We have no excuse for not loving everyone. We have no excuse whatsoever. If we have a labor of love, the kind of love that God has for us, that's the perfect example. So we have a biblical example, and that can make us a better person too. And then the third thing we'd like to look at is the patience of hope, and once again, in God's sight. This is one of the great not only benefits but attributes, characteristics that we could ever put upon or learn how to do and have it in our life, and that is patience. And just to be honest, if God wasn't patient, probably every one of us here and probably everybody in the world would be lost. Christians sin from time to time too. Even though we've been forgiven, sometimes we fall short and we sin. But God's patient with us. And so we too need to learn that patience, the patience that God has. And put that type of patience into our life and not be willing to throw up our arms and quit. Some people are just that close to succeeding, but they just don't have the patience to endure and they quit. And they never make it. And they spend the rest of their lives being miserable because they think other people are being favored over them because other people get the good and they don't. And it was their own fault because they were that close. So be patient. It's a very important virtue. God is the God of patience. Most certainly he is. And I'm thankful that he is. I'm thankful that my God is faithful. Patient with me. I've not been always in my life, and I still try to do what's right, but I come up short in certain things, and I get so mad at myself sometimes and angry, but God's patient. And there's just a lot of things I learn about life and myself and the way I handle things, and so then I can learn to do better. Romans 15 and verse 5. Now may the God of patience and comfort grant you to be like-minded towards one another according to Christ Jesus. The God of patient or patience. There's the standard. And so, you know, if you get tired, well, have you been as patient as God? Well, no. So what's that tell us? We need to get more patient, right? You need to work harder on it. You've got to have patience. Tribulations will bring about patience. This is a kind of an odd thing. The world doesn't think this way, but it obviously doesn't know the truth that's been revealed to us. Romans 5 and verse 3. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulation, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and that's the idea of patience, and perseverance, character. And character, hope. That's what we're talking about, character tonight. These three things are things that will build character in our life and make our lives fuller. And when we come sound in the faith, and that's only through patience. It's just how we become sound. It takes patience. And someone might ask, well, now, preacher, how much patience? The rest of your life. Patience. The rest of your living days, patient. That's how patient we've got to learn to be. And we need to understand that's how patient God has been with me. That's why I just can't always, and I try never to, and hopefully I've been better at it, not to jump at conclusions to anybody. Nor be ready to you know, just say, well, yeah, that's a terrible sin. You know, I mean, you're just a sinner. Well, we can't do that. The Bible says we can't curse men because men were made in the image of God. So we've got to be patient. Got to have patience. And God will help us to have patience, and we'll benefit from it. Titus 2 and verse 2. That the older men be sober, reverent, temperate, sound in the faith, in love, impatient. Impatience. We have to have patience. And these are things, these three things that we're talking about this evening, they will develop in us the virtues that we want. And so as we bring this lesson to conclusion, that's why I say there are three necessary things. The Christian virtues will develop in us perfection in our Christian life. That's what we're doing. We're developing perfection. Scripture tells us to be perfect, and that's what we do through these faith and our labor of love and our work of faith and our work of patience, as Paul led out and taught to us in 1 Thessalonians 1 and verse 3, remember without ceasing the work of faith, labor of love, and patience of hope. These will develop in us the virtues that we desire to have. They'll make us a better person. They'll make us a happier person. And more importantly, they'll save us. And in conclusion, I'd like to read with you Matthew chapter 5, verse 43, beginning, and read for the next five verses. These are a quote from our Lord. Jesus said, you've heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. And it doesn't mean it's a male thing. It's sons and daughters. It includes everybody. You shall be sons of your Father in heaven, for he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? Therefore ye shall be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Love your enemies, love everybody, do good to everyone. And sometimes it's difficult to love somebody. Sometimes it's hard. But we got to do it. Because if we don't, we're not different than anybody else. Lord really put a strange test on us. It's a hard one. That's why prayer is such an important thing, because it's really hard and difficult to get there. But through these three things, through the work of faith, the labor of love and patience, we'll get there. That we can have that kind of perfect love that God has. If you're here this evening and not a Christian, you've not obeyed the gospel, or perhaps there's sin in your life, as Jimmy talked about sin this morning in the lesson, a good lesson, or they're just things that are weighing you down and burdening you, whatever it is, we're here to pray for you. We love one another. We're brothers and sisters in Christ. We're all trying to work together for our eternal home. And so it's such important. The Bible says here, believe, repent, confess, and be buried with your Lord in baptism. Baptism is necessary, not because I say so, or not because anybody else says here, but because God says so. And that is a work of God. It's not a work of man. If you're subject in any way, come now while we stand together and sing a song of encouragement.
Hark the gentle voice of Jesus.